Welcome. We are so excited you are joining us for service today. If you are new, we want to say a special ikomomai, welcome. We do have connect cards for you to fill out, and if you bring it over to the coffee cart, we'd love to bless you with a specialty coffee as well as a book. You can find the connect cards in the backs of the seat if you're sitting in the foyer or in the sanctuary, and if you're out in the amphitheater, you can find them at the connect tent. If you're joining us for the first time online, you can fill out our digital connect card on Waipuna Chapel's homepage. Connect cards are a great way to write down any questions if you want to serve anywhere, or if you have any praise reports or prayer requests. We love to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. We are so thankful to have such a generous church family. If you feel led to give today, mahalo. And if you're new and joining us for the first time, we're just so thankful you're here and blessed that you're here. We don't want you to have any pressure on giving. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says, "Each one must give as he has decided in his own heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." We have different ways to give here at Waipuna. You can give online at waipunachapel.com. You can text to give. You can give on the Church Center app, or you can also just drop your giving at one of the boxes located by the coffee cart, the sanctuary doors, and then outside by the connect table. Also, if you're on social media, feel free to like and follow us on Instagram and Facebook for updates and announcements. Mahalo in partnering with us in our mission, which is journeying with people in a growing relationship with Jesus Christ by loving God, loving others, and serving the world.
Hello, Waipuna Chapel. We have several announcements this week. We would like to invite you to join us and other believers on Maui for a United in Prayer event on July 31st at 6 p.m. at Haggai Institute in Kihei. Please register with the QR code shown on the screen and in the bulletin, as seats are limited. Another event we would like to invite you to is a free worship concert hosted here at Waipuna Chapel on Monday, July 26th at 6:30 p.m. We will be hosting worship minister Larry Sturm and four of his worship arts students from Christ for the Nations Institute. Here's a short promo video about who they are.
Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Arts Collective has been a safe place for creative teens and young adults to bring the specific gifts that God has planted in each of their hearts and use it across the nations. So here is a little video of what we do here.
I've been thinking about time and where does it go? How can I stop my life from passing me by? I don't know. I've been thinking about family, now it's growing so fast. Will I wake up one morning just wishing that I could go back? I've been thinking about lately, maybe I can make a change and let it change me. So with all of my heart, this is my prayer. Singing, oh Lord, keep me in the moment. Help me live with my eyes wide open. Cause I don't wanna miss what you have for me. Singing, oh Lord, show me what matters. Throw away what I'm chasing after. Cause I don't wanna miss what you have.
Awesome. Good evening, everyone. My name's Trevor. Will you stand as we begin our service and worship?
Nothing can separate, even if I ran away. Your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't. to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails. Your love never fails. Wind is strong and the water's deep. I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. Chasm was far too wide, I never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages, your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the ocean drench, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never. Your love never fails. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages, and your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, and your love never fails. Your love never
fails. Jesus, we are so thankful for your love. Thank you that sometimes we're not the best people. Sometimes we just do dumb things. And your love never fails us. Lord, that you continue loving us. Lord, that we have the evidence of the cross and what you have done. Lord, to show us what you will do and continue to do in our lives. So just we say thank you. Lord, we just ask that our eyes and our hearts be focused on you tonight as we worship. Lord, and that you'd receive our praise and our love.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, say that thou art. Day, oh.
Jesus.
Yes, Jesus, you're where we find our hope, God. Lord, everything, Lord, even in the midst of life where we get busy and we think we can do it on our own and we try, just take this moment to proclaim that you are our living hope. God, that we need you. That we take this moment out of our week just to pause and to say, God, we need you. Gonna end this set on a funner older song. I call it a golden oldie. Tim told me I'm not old enough to know a golden oldie, but we're gonna play it anyways.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky, but my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all. Reflect the beauty of my Lord, 'cause you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour.
Jesus, we love you. God, we ask that you would reign in our lives, that people would see you through us. God, that our imperfect reflection of your perfect love would make you famous on this island. Lord, and as we hear your word this morning, just ask that you, or this evening, that you just open our ears and our hearts to know you, God, and to have revelation of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
We are Maui Rescue Mission, and we have a mobile hygiene trailer that we bring out to multiple locations on the island. We set the trailer up every week in the same spot so that the people know we're coming. We provide showers, we provide laundry, we provide hygiene items, first aid items, clothing, just try to meet their basic needs. So what's so important about what we do is that we do bring dignity to people and we bring hope. A lot of the people that we serve out on the street have lost hope and they've given up. They've tried over and over and they've hit brick walls. And what we're here to do is tell them, look, there's still a chance and we're here to help you with that. And we're here to lift you up and give you hope. There are so many different ways that we're trying to help, and one of the ways is we have volunteers that are sitting down with our friends and helping them apply for stimulus checks, where they're helping them apply for SNAP benefits, all the things that the system is there and set up to help them with, but they just don't know how to access it. So we're trying to help them with that. So as a community, if you'd like to support what we do, there's three ways you could do it. One is donations of items, hygiene items, clothing, first aid items. And the other way is donations of financial donations. The other way you can help is to come out and serve. We need boots on the ground. We need people to sit with our friends and get to know them and talk to them. And we need people to help clean the showers and run the laundry. Please give us a call, go online, send us a message. We'd love to help get you connected.
Right on. All right. Hey there. My name's Joshua, one of the pastors at Waipuna, and I want to invite Abel Garcia to come on up. And he's, yeah. So as you heard about, Maui Rescue Mission does a lot of great things here on this island, and you can find out more on their website, and we have information outside as well. And we have a lay for you, Abel. Yeah. All right. So it's a privilege to know Abel as a friend and get to serve with him. And then the last 2.5 years, he's been the director of operations at Maui Rescue Mission. So let's just say a prayer for Abel. If you're comfortable, why don't you reach out your hands and let's pray for Abel as he brings the word tonight. So God, I thank you so much for Abel and for his family. I just pray for your blessings and just continued love to be poured out on them, Lord. Thank you for his bride and his two kids, and we pray for them. We also lift up the great work you're doing at Maui Rescue Mission, God, and we pray for continued volunteers, a great team there, as well as all of the resources and support that they need to do what you've called them to do. We just pray that you'd open the eyes of our hearts tonight and that we'd hear not Abel's words tonight, but we'd hear from you. And that you'd fill him with your Holy Spirit. Let him enjoy this time as he shares your truth. And we just pray you'd speak through him in a clear way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Kind of loud. That's why. Sorry. Like, why is it so loud? Well, it's really a joy to be here with you guys tonight. My wife and my children and I are members here at Waipuna Chapel. We have been since we moved here. Almost 3 years ago, and it's been a blessing to us. So I was really excited when Pastor Sean invited me to speak, and I'm also excited that him and Jess get a chance to get some much-needed rest and relaxation this weekend. So this morning's message is titled, Jesus' Mission, Our Response, and it's going to be kind of a testimonial sermon or message. So I'm going to share a little bit about my story, how my family and I ended up on Maui doing homeless ministry. And I'm going to intertwine it with a little bit of scripture. So if you'd like, if you have a Bible on your phone or with you, or there's one in front of you on the back of the seat in front of you, you can go ahead and prepare yourself by turning to Luke chapter 19. We're going to be looking at the story of Zacchaeus, as well as the story of the rich young ruler, which comes the previous chapter, chapter 18. The main passage we're going to be looking at is the passage of Zacchaeus, which is found in Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. If this is your first time at church and you're not familiar with the Bible is split up into two parts. The first part is the Old Testament. The second part is the New Testament. And so we're in the New Testament. And it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, so the third book in the New Testament. chapter 19. Before we dive in, though, I'd like to read Psalm 77, verse 11 and 12 as a prayer, because I think it's going to be important to what I'm going to share this morning. So let me pray that over us this morning, or this evening. Thank you. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your works and meditate on your mighty deeds. Lord, this morning, as I share the mighty deeds that you've done in my life, and as we look at your word, which contains stories of the mighty deeds that you did in days of old, I pray that you would challenge us. I pray that you would reveal yourself to us, and that you would spur us to be on mission, to be on your mission in our community, in our workplace, and wherever you may lead us. In Jesus' name, amen. So a little brief story about my family and how we ended up on Maui. So as Josh mentioned, I married my wife. Her name is Jennifer. We're going on 19 years of marriage this year in December. Very excited about that. And we have two young children. My son, Toby, is 6 years old. And my daughter, Emma, is 8 years old. We moved here almost 3 years ago in October to help Maui Rescue Mission launch. So they had a trailer. It was just arriving on island, and they needed someone to operate the trailer and kind of be the outreach director. And at the time, prior to that, I had been serving at a church in Jacksonville, Florida. My wife and I are originally from Miami, Florida, born and raised. Outside of going to seminary in San Francisco for 4 years, I basically spent my entire life in Miami. After seminary, I ended up in Jacksonville as a missions pastor at a large church. And one of my greatest passions and the reason I ended up at that church is I grew up in church, and I'm going to share some of that story in a little bit, but as part of my story, I had kind of grown dissatisfied in church as a kid. And when God recaptured my life, I felt a passion to help the body of Christ, the people who are the church, not the building, the people of God, recognize that when we become followers of Christ, we become missionaries. And so I ended up at the church in Jacksonville in a role of missions associate, and my main role was to mobilize the body of Christ to live on mission. Spent 6 years there, and my last year there kind of began to feel dissatisfied, and not in a negative way. It was a great church, actually very similar to Waipuna Chapel. I loved it. But most of my time during the week was spent in the office and on the weekends with church members. And I had a really large heart for folks that were outside of the church. So I'm a surfer. Anytime I got to spend time in the water, if those of you who are surfers, you end up talking with people. And oftentimes conversations would lead to what I did for work and would lead to conversations about the Bible or about ministry. And that was really kind of what got me pumped. And so I had become dissatisfied, and in that process discovered that God was preparing me for a new season of ministry. And initially we thought God was preparing to send us to plant a church somewhere. We were feeling called to do what's called intentional relational ministry. So instead of being focused on having a building, it would be focused on developing relationships that led to spiritual conversations that would in turn lead to discipleship and then becoming a church. And kind of multiplying that. In that process, someone from Maui who had actually reached out to me a year prior called me up. He was looking for churches on the mainland that would be interested in partnering with churches in Hawaii for missional purposes. He happened to be coming through Jacksonville on his way to South Florida and said, "Hey, can we get coffee?" And the last thing I expected was that conversation would lead to the beginning of what would end up as my wife and I and our kids moving to Maui. But that's what happened. Halfway through the conversation, he mentioned some things that kind of stirred my heart and kind of gave me chicken skin. I came home from the meeting. I mentioned what had been said at the meeting to my wife. My wife's not a surfer. She loves the ocean, but She didn't necessarily have an interest to move to Hawaii, but her immediate response was, "So when do we move?" And immediately I knew that God was up to something. And so fast forward a few months, a trip in July. We spent a week here. We went back home and said, "Yeah, I think we're supposed to move." We really felt like God was in it. 4 days after deciding that we were supposed to move, and we had decided, okay, we're supposed to move. Let's move in 6 months. Okay, so we have the six-month timeline. 4 days later, I get a text message from the pastor at Lahaina Baptist, who we had met with while we were here. And the text message basically said, "Hey, I know you guys are in the process of moving. There's this new nonprofit. They're looking for a director of outreach and operations, and you're the only name that came to my mind. Here's the link to their website. Check it out, and let me know if you want a connection." It was 11 o'clock at night in Florida when I got that text message, so I looked at it. I was like, homeless ministry? I've never done homeless ministry. I'll look at this in the morning. I put my phone down and went back to sleep. The next morning, I looked their website up, and what struck me was that our desire up until that point was to do relational ministry. And the whole purpose of this trailer, see, there's many trailers like ours, but most of them just have showers. And a shower only takes about 5 minutes. The purpose of having a laundry room in our trailer is not only because there's a need for clean clothes, but it takes about an hour and a half to get a load of laundry done, which means now I have a captive audience for an hour and a half. And so the purpose of the trailer is to allow us to develop relationships, because it's through relationships that we gain trust and we get the privilege of walking alongside someone to help them either get connected to Jesus or get connected to other resources that are necessary for them to get their lives back together. And so I checked out the website. I told my wife about it. A few days later, I talked to the executive director at the time. 2 days after that, I talked to the board. And at the end of the conversation, they said, "Wow, it sounds like you're a great fit for our organization, but there's one problem." I'm like, "What's the problem?" They said, "You're planning to move in 6 months. We need someone who can be here in 6 weeks." And I was like, "Whoa, that is a problem." And so I said, "Well, it's not impossible, but you know, let me pray about it, talk with my wife, and I'll get back to you." They had given me some options. You can travel back and forth until you're ready to move, or you can decide to move in 6 weeks. I said, "Well, the traveling back and forth with two young kids being left behind with my wife is not going to happen, but we'll pray about it." Long story short, here I am. We prayed about it, decided yes. We sold everything except for 6 plastic bins worth of our stuff. And we were on a plane to Maui. Someone we met while we were here in July had helped us find a place temporarily. And it's been a God story ever since. God's provided for our needs as well as given us relational blessings to help Maui Rescue Mission grow and thrive, but also for our family to grow and thrive. So that's kind of how we got here. What God is doing now, as you saw that video, that is our executive director, Scott, in that video. And what's been going on now is that our mobile hygiene trailer, our mobile dignity trailer, has become a mobile resource center. So our desire has always been to be open to partnering with other agencies, whether they're Christian or not, that provide the missing links to helping the folks that we serve get up and out of their situation. So we provide hygiene and dignity, but we've currently been partnering with Malama Ikeola, which is a free health clinic, and they send out a nurse and 2 healthcare workers, and then twice a week they send out a drug counselor. Thanks to them, we've been able to do on-the-spot doctor visits via telehealth appointments for our clients. We were able to help a client by calling 911 when he was having some sort of heart condition. And that's been a huge blessing. They've done free vaccines for our clients and for our friends is what we call them. We also partner with Project Vision, who does food stamps and food insecurities. We partner with the folks from the shelter. We partner with volunteers that have computer skills, and we're open to a number of other partnerships. And so God's been really good and really faithful. We've been able to help some of our clients get back home to the mainland to get into programs or to get back connected to families. We've helped families and individuals get into housing. This morning, in fact, I was in Lahaina this morning, and one of the biggest challenges our homeless friends deal with is their personal items either get lost or stolen often. And if you know, in order to get an ID or in order to get a job, you need proof of who you are. And that usually requires a photo ID or a license, a birth certificate, a social security card. And when you lose any or all of those things, to get them back is difficult if you have resources. It's twice as difficult if you don't have resources. And so this morning, a gentleman who's been waiting a few months that our volunteers have worked with received his birth certificate and his social security card and one other item, I don't remember what it was, and then we were able to send him to the Salvation Army to get a letter from them so that he could go to the DMV and get his ID without having to pay the fee. Because that's, you know, on top of getting all your paperwork, now you have to pay fees to get your license. And so it's been a huge blessing. It's sometimes emotionally taxing, but most of the time it's just exciting to be used by God to be a blessing in the lives of those in our community. With that, that's kind of a quick introduction to who I am and what I do. With that, I want us to look into the Word of God at Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. We're going to take a quick look at the story of Zacchaeus. And it says, as he entered into Jericho, and this is Jesus, and was passing through, behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. And he was seeking to see who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, and if you've got your own Bible or your app, you can underline this, or you can just make a note in your notes. He said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So Zacchaeus hurried, came down from the tree, and received Jesus joyfully. And when the crowd saw this, they grumbled. He has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone anything, I restore it fourfold. And to this Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of God, or Son of Man, came to seek and to save the lost. A little bit of background on this story. This story is the conclusion to Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, which starts in chapter 9. So in chapter 9, Jesus' kind of ministry begins, where it involves healing and teaching, and like the teaching of how to pray, the Lord's Prayer is in that section. And so this is that process. And chapter 19 comes right, or this verse comes right before Jesus makes his triumphal entry, which is Palm Sunday. Okay? And it's kind of the climax of that entire section. And it builds on a recurring theme. If you were to go back through from chapter 9 all the way through chapter 19 and read all the stories, what you're going to see is that Jesus does something, or he says something, and the people respond, or an individual responds. And so the theme throughout this section is, what is the right response to Jesus, and what is the wrong response to Jesus? And so we're going to talk a little bit about that in the two sections that we're reading today. The cost of following Jesus is one of the passages, one of the sections in that section of verses. The feeding of the 5,000, the healings, the parables, like the parable of the persistent widow, is all in that section. Additionally, it illustrates the epitome of Jesus' messianic mission statement from Luke 4, 16 through 21. So at the beginning of Luke, when you get to chapter 4, right before chapter 4, Jesus goes into the wilderness to pray. And while he's in the wilderness fasting and praying for 40 days, the devil tempts him. He comes out of the wilderness and he goes into the church, into the synagogue in Nazareth. And when he's in there, they give him, it's the Sabbath, and they give him the scroll of Isaiah. And Jesus reads from the scroll, and I'm going to read to you what he says, because many scholars and many people, as you read it, you'll say, yeah, duh, this is his mission statement. Many people will say that these verses that Jesus read set up what Jesus does from that point on. And so it says, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then he rolls the scroll up, gives it back to the attendant, and everybody's eyes are like fixed on him, and he begins to say to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your presence. This scripture is fulfilled in me." And as you can imagine, Jesus says these things among all these educated Jewish people, and some of them are stunned that he would, the audacity of him to say this, but some of them are also intrigued, because as he reads these scriptures, you know that he's reading them with authority and with power, and it's going right through to the heart of many. And so what we're looking at today, the story of Zacchaeus and the story of the rich young ruler, kind of play into the fulfillment of what Jesus says in that beginning chapter 4 of Luke. It illustrates, the story of Zacchaeus illustrates the idea of true repentance. You know, many times when you're in church, if you've been in church for a while, you hear the definition of repentance as a complete turnaround. So my life was going this way, the opposite direction of God, and as a result of my encounter with Jesus, I did a complete, not 360, but a complete 180 and turned around. But I'm going to give you a different definition today. It doesn't contradict that one, but I think it goes a little bit beyond the simplicity of that. And so here's the definition that I've written down, and it may be up on a slide. If it's not, you can go back and listen to this. There it is. It says, true repentance is a new relationship to God and to others. So it's not just a new relationship to God, but it's also a new relationship to others, because when we're living a life of sin, many times the way we look at others is not the way God looks at them. We look at them based on what we can gain from them, or we look at them based on what we think we lack because we see them containing those things. And so true repentance not only changes our relationship to God, but it also changes our relationship to his people, to all created beings, in a way that reflects God's will for human existence, in a way basically that reflects the heart of God. All right, so one more time. A new relationship to God and others in a way that reflects the heart of God. Before we move on, I want to kind of go back to what we've been studying over the last, what has it been, like five teachings that we've been on, the book of the book of Samuel, talking about the life of David, right? And a couple weeks ago, we talked about David's sin with Bathsheba. And so I want to read to you a section from Psalms 51, which is David's prayer of repentance, because I think it highlights this idea of new relationship to God and others in a way that reflects the heart of God. So let me read that to you really quick. I'm just going to read from 10 to 17, but you can read the whole prayer on your own time. It says here, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. And then here's the response part. Listen to what David says. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltness, O God, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. So there we see an example of true repentance. And in my life, you see, I grew up in church. I went to seminary. I'm an ordained pastor. I do homeless ministry. And from the outside, many people would look at my life and say, oh, wow. In fact, some of the homeless folks that I work with, they think that I've got it all together. And they don't realize that being a Christ follower doesn't mean that we have it all together or that we've always had it all together. And so in my life, I've had my share of challenges. And so when I read the story of Zacchaeus, I can relate to him. You see, my parents are Cuban immigrants or refugees. They came to the United States as young kids after Castro came into power, which is kind of timely in light of what's going on in Cuba right now. But prior to coming to Cuba, in fact, prior to being born, on both sides of my family, my grandparents and their parents came to the Lord through Christian missionaries in Cuba. And so I grew up in a Christian home in Miami, in a kind of traditional Baptist Christian home. I came to accept the Lord at a very, very young age and understood what that meant. In fact, as a young kid, I often tried to share the story of Jesus and the story of salvation with my friends. But I would find it difficult to invite my friends to church because the church that I grew up in, even though it was a great Bible-teaching church, it wasn't a very welcoming place. Sometimes even as a kid, I could tell who the outsiders were. They didn't seem welcome. And in my understanding of the gospel and of the message of Jesus, that kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And so as I grew older into my middle school and high school years, I drifted from the Lord. I stopped attending church. I had become a surfer, and so surfing kind of became my God, my obsession, and partying and hanging out with my friends kind of went along with that. And so for about 3 years, my last year of high school, my first 2 years of college, I was running hard away from God. And at night, sometimes after partying all night, I would drive home with the Christian radio station on, which is kind of odd. You know, I'd be out partying and drinking and stuff, and then I'd drive home and weep as I listened to preachers on the radio. And I'd get home and I'd want to pray, and I would allow the devil to convince me that I wasn't deserving of God's forgiveness. I would just weep in my bed. And it wasn't until a friend of mine that I had grown up with invited me to a church about 20 minutes from my house that was very similar to Waipuna, very welcoming, very contemporary, that God grabbed a hold of my life. I walked into church one Saturday night, and the music was cool. The message was easy to understand. And I could tell that I was sitting in a place where people's lives were changed, but they weren't wearing masks. They weren't trying to pretend that their life was all together. And something about that just grabbed a hold of my heart. And within a week or two of attending, within a few times attending the church, I rededicated my life, and soon I got involved in ministry. I began serving in middle school ministry. Initially, I was reluctant. The middle school pastor had approached me to serve, and I said, you know, if you knew my story, you wouldn't want me to work with these students. And he challenged me. He said, well, have you not accepted the Lord as your Savior or rededicated your life? I said, yeah, absolutely. And so he said to me, well, what makes you think that what Christ did on the cross is not enough to forgive you from the choices that you've made in the past? And that just radically changed my perspective on where I was at the time. As I began to serve, what I discovered was that God wanted to use my mess. And I want you to understand this because he wants to use your mess too as part of his redemption story. You see, Jesus came and he hung on a cross. And after hanging on the cross, he rose from the dead and he appeared to his disciples. And before going back to heaven, he left them this challenge: go and make disciples. And so we get to be partners with God as Christians. We get to be partners with God on his mission. So we've been redeemed from our mess to be conduits or tools or pathways of redemption in the lives of the people that God puts in our path. And sometimes it's the messes that we've overcome and that God's redeemed us from that are necessary to allow us the ability to understand and to help our neighbor come to know the Lord. And that's what I've discovered in my life, is that God's used my mess to break my heart for his people and to make me more sensitive to love those that he loves and to see them the way he sees them. And so that's my story. That's, you know, I started working as a volunteer and as an intern at the church. I met my wife at that church. We got married. My undergrad's in elementary education. I began teaching in the public schools and was actually, again, it seems like every transition point in my life is a season of kind of discontent or discouragement or uncertainty. So we had gotten married. I had graduated from college, and I was like, okay, now I'm going to go into ministry. And instead, I became a teacher and started teaching, and there was no opportunity for me to get further involved at the church I was at, and so I was kind of discouraged. And then our church started doing what's called multi-site campuses. So we were doing, you know, for example, we had a church service that met at a movie theater and had a video presentation of the pastor, something that's pretty common now, but back then it wasn't very common. And so one of our pastors was asked to be the campus pastor, and he called me up one day and said, hey, will you come and be our youth pastor? And it was as a volunteer, but here was an opportunity for me to take a deeper step in ministry. And so I was like, yes, absolutely, I'm excited, let's do it. And so over the course of the following year, God used that to kind of challenge me and prepare me and to call me to go into seminary. And so we moved to California. I spent 4 years in seminary studying to get better educated about the Bible and history and all that stuff. And during our time there, my wife had always had a passion to be foster parents. And so here I was working on a master's degree and taking care of foster children. We had 4 different placements over the 4 years. And talk about a challenge. You're trying to study, trying to prepare yourself, trying to work hard at your studies and remember the Old Testament and Greek and Hebrew, while also having to deal with the challenges of a foster child. But in that process, God began to teach me about what it meant for God to love us as a father. You see, because I knew that my father and mother loved me, but I was their biological child. I kind of took that for granted. As a foster parent, I began to love the children that were in our home in a way that reminded me of what it says in the Bible, that we've been adopted into the family of God as Christ followers. And so we're no longer seen as enemies of God, but we're seen as children of God. And so that really transformed my life at that point. I graduated from seminary, ended up at that church, and that passion that I had for mission and for ministering to the community, little did I know that it would lead to moving to Maui. Now, there was 2 parts to that. I was excited for ministry, definitely very, very excited for ministry. But there's another part. I've been a surfer for a long time. And so many times I prayed before we took this job and before we moved here, many times I prayed, okay, God, if I'm moving there just because of the surf, close the door. And instead of closing the door, God continued to open the door. And so here I was suddenly moving to Maui, to a place that I had dreamed about surfing at some point and almost kind of had stopped dreaming about it, because when you grow up in Miami, the idea of flying out to Maui to surf somewhere like Honolulu Bay or something becomes kind of impossible. And next thing you know, I was here. And so the reason I tell you that part of the story is that, you know, sometimes, at least for me as a Christian growing up, sometimes I thought that being a Christian meant denying the things that I was passionate about, the dreams that I had. And what God was showing me was that, follow me, and I will give you the desires of your heart, like icing on the cake. And it doesn't always happen that way. I'm not saying, you know, don't get me wrong. Being a Christian is hard. You know, Monday at Outreach, we had three different people say that they were suicidal. We had to call 911. That's hard. But God doesn't just care about us because he wants to complete our mission through us. He cares about us because he created us. And he gave us those passions because through those passions, he uses us to be a blessing to others. And so here I was moving to Maui, not only to serve God, but feeling that God was also honoring some of the desires of my heart that I thought I would never afford to be able to do or get a chance to do. And so what I like to say, and it's one of the points on the screen, is that we've been redeemed to be conduits of redemption. We've been redeemed to be conduits of redemption. In the same way that you turn on a light switch, you know, if I go over to the light switch and I turn it off, I basically interrupt the connection, right? And so when we become a Christ follower, we were living disconnected from God. Now we're living connected to God. And when we're living connected to God, God's able to use our life to reflect his love to those around us. And so we've been redeemed to be conduits of his redemption. All right, so that's the positive story, is the story of Zacchaeus and his joyful response to Jesus. But, you know, in the midst of my journey, and perhaps in the midst of your journey, and among the people that I've shared the word of God with, sometimes we get a different response. And so I'd like for us to take a look quickly at Luke 18, verses 18 through 30, and see how the rich young ruler responded to Jesus. Because I think there's a warning in there for us as well. Okay? And so the encouragement is to be conduits of redemption, but the warning is found here in this verse. I'm going to read it to you. It says, "And a ruler asked him, 'Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?' And Jesus said to him, 'Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother.' And to this, the ruler said to him, 'All these I have kept from my youth.'" And I underline that because I'm sure he was earnest in his response. But I don't know about you. When I read that, I can't help but chuckle. You couldn't have kept all of this from your youth. You may have done a very good job at keeping them, but nobody is perfect. So when Jesus heard this, he said to him, instead of calling him out on the fact that he couldn't have kept these, Jesus just said this: "One thing you still lack. Sell all that you have and distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." But when the rich young ruler heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. And Jesus, seeing that he had become sad, said, "How difficult it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. You see, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And those who heard this said, "Then who can be saved?" Because if that's the case, who can be saved? But he said, "What is impossible with man is possible with God." And Peter said, "See, we have left our homes and followed you." And he said to them, Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brother or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times more in this time and in the age to come eternal life. What a contrast. What a contrast between Zacchaeus, who was despised. You know, my wife and I have been watching this television series called The Chosen. You have to download the app, but it's basically a story of the disciples. And it's really, really well done. But in the first season, I guess, they show Matthew, who later becomes the Matthew that we know. But he was a tax collector. And it's interesting to watch the show and get an idea of what it must have been like to be a tax collector. Because we read it, we know that they're despised, but do we truly understand what it must have been like to be a tax collector? Or to be a Jewish person who has become a tax collector? Because you're basically choosing to sell out your people for money. And so a tax collector, even though they're rich, they're despised. People see them and they walk on the other side of the road. They spit at them just like they would a beggar or a sick person or a thief. And yet Zacchaeus responds to Jesus with joy. Zacchaeus thought that he was seeking Jesus, and yet we see in the passage that we read earlier that Jesus already knew his name, and Jesus stopped precisely where Zacchaeus was and called him out of the tree. And Zacchaeus joyfully invited Jesus to come into his house when Jesus said he needed to be at his house. But the rich young ruler thinks he has it all together. He thinks he's obeyed the law to the T. And when Jesus reveals to him what he's lacking, which is complete surrender, because I don't think Jesus wanted his money. You know, we could be remiss to read that and think, well, I'm not rich, I don't have to worry about that. But the reality is, we're all rich in some way. You know, if God was to ask you to give up, I don't know, for me, maybe surfing, would I be willing to give it up? If God was to ask you to sell your home and move 3,000 miles across the country to serve him, would you do it? See, that was the situation that the rich young ruler found himself in. And he wasn't able to do it. Instead of leaving joyfully from that encounter with Jesus, he left dejected. He couldn't give it up. Not only could he not give it up, and he left dejected, he missed an opportunity to walk with Jesus and learn from Jesus, because that's what Jesus was inviting him to follow him, to be a disciple. And so my question to you is, what is it that God maybe tugging you to, or what things have you had in your life that God's had to slowly teach you to let go of? I often use this illustration of the open and closed palm because it's really powerful. You see, God calls us to live this way with an open palm. And I would encourage you to go ahead and open your palm. You don't have to hold it up, just open it in front of you. When your palms are open, anything that you have is freely given, but also anything that someone else has that they want to give to you is freely received. But if you close your palm, is that possible? And so what I would ask you, while you're holding your hands closed, I would ask you to ask God, what am I still holding on to? What am I still holding on to? Because it doesn't matter how long you've been a Christian. I guarantee you there's still things that you're holding on to. I know in my life, and I've given up a lot, there's still a lot of things that I'm holding on to. My pride is one. Yeah? And so sometimes maybe we think our hand is open, but actually we've got a few fingers holding on to something. Yeah? Okay? So that's a good picture to keep in your mind as we think of this. The other illustration I have here about this is, you know, as a child of Cuban immigrants, Cuba holds a special place in my heart. And I have this quote from a Cuban pastor, but it could be applied to any pastor in any third world country. And I want you to listen to it, because this is what Zacchaeus understood, but the rich young ruler failed to understand. And here's what it says. It says, "The blessing of living in an oppressive country with few possessions is that you see the move of God in more obvious ways." I'll read it one more time. "The blessing of living in an oppressive country with few possessions is that you see the move of God in more obvious ways." And so sometimes, and I know it's true in my life, sometimes those things that I don't even realize that I'm holding on to are the things that keep me from seeing that God is at work all around me. And therefore, it keeps me from experiencing his joy. Early on when we started doing the trailer, a young man came and volunteered with me. And we got to the end of, during the time that he volunteered with me, we were at Hope Chapel still, and we had been doing a Bible study. And so he sat with us when we did the Bible study with our friends. And when it was time to tear down the trailer, it was just him and I. He opened his mouth and he said, "You know, I enjoyed that Bible study, but maybe if I could see God's miracles, I would believe." And I couldn't help but kind of chuckle, because I was like, I don't think he realized that he said that to the wrong person. And so I began to engage him. Based on his response, I kind of had a feeling that he had grown up in church. And so I began to engage him and ask him questions. And sure enough, he had a similar story to mine, where he had grown up in church, but he had been discouraged by some things. But instead of continuing to respond to the fact that God was seeking him out, he chose to continue to reject and reject, to the point where now he struggles to believe that there's even a God, because he doesn't see God at work. And so I shared with him my testimony. I said, "Well, you know, if you don't mind listening to me chat for a little bit while we disassemble the trailer and put it away, I'd like to share my story with you. And when we get to the end of it, if you don't think God's still at work, fine, but I think you'll have a different point of view." And sure enough, as I started to share with him some of the things that God has done in my life and how we ended up moving to Maui and some of the details that I didn't include, such as financial things that have been covered for us and blessings that we've had that made it very clear that God was saying yes and go, and, you know, divine appointments with people that were key to helping the trailer get set up in the places that it's currently set up. For example, I'll give you one example. Before, when we first moved here, one of the main things that was keeping us from running the trailer was that on Maui, unlike on the mainland, we don't have campsites where you can get an RV and plug it in and dump your wastewater. And our trailer has wastewater tanks, and I need to do something with the wastewater. And so before we could even get started, I had to figure out what to do with our wastewater. Otherwise, we would be stuck. And so I got invited by an artist in Makawao, where we were living, to a Chamber of Commerce event. And I went to this event, and I happened to be talking to this gentleman at the event about what I did for a living. And he was really intrigued, and he said, "Well, where are you guys running?" And I said, "Well, we're not yet. We're trying to figure out what to do with our wastewater." And he smiled, took out his card, gave me his card, and said, "Well, give me a call on Monday. I think we can fix that for you." Well, it turned out that the man I was talking to was the owner and operator of Valley Isle Pumping. And so ever since then, they donate the pumping of our trailer once a week. And that's totally a God thing. I can give you several examples of things just like that that God has done in our lives that make it obvious that God's at work. But if I was too stuck on the things that aren't working out or the things that I'm not willing to let go of, I wouldn't be able to see it. I wouldn't be able to respond to it. I wouldn't be able to embrace it and experience the joy. And so in that conversation I had with this young man, we got to the end of my conversation, and he was speechless. He was like, well, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe God still does miracles. I said, yeah, he does. But we're so spoiled. We're so blessed in this country that our blessing sometimes is a curse. So, which one are you going to be? Are you going to be Zacchaeus? Or are you going to be the rich young ruler? And maybe you are already responding to Jesus. Are there places in your life that you still need to let go? Will we respond with sadness and dejection, or with repentance and joyful obedience? You see, Jesus' mission includes us participating with it. So what will our response be? Let me pray for us. And I'd like to pray Psalms 51 from the Message, because it kind of is neat the way it words it, and then we'll be dismissed. It says, generous in love, God, give grace. Huge in mercy, wipe out my bad record. Scrub away my guilt. Soak out my sins in your laundry. I know how bad I've been. My sins are staring me down. You're the one I've violated, and you've seen it all, seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. I've been out of step with you for a long time, in the wrong since before I was born. What you are after is truth from the inside out. Enter me, Lord, then. Conceive a new true life. Soak me in your laundry, and I'll come out clean. Scrub me, and I'll have a snow-white life. Tune me into the foot-tapping songs. Set these once broken bones to dancing. Don't look too close for blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a Genesis week from the chaos of my life. Don't throw me out with the trash or fail to breathe holiness in me. Bring me back from my gray exile. Put a fresh wind in my sails. Give me a job teaching rebels your ways so that the lost can find their way home. Commute my death sentence, God, my salvation, God, and I'll sing anthems to your life-giving ways. Unbutton my lips, dear God, and I'll let loose with your praise. Lord, may that be true of us. Would you reveal areas in our lives that are keeping us from being able to rejoice and sing your praise, and as a result, that are causing us to miss your work in and around us each and every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God, amen. I'd hate to miss the opportunity to respond. You know, this message is about a response to God, and I really believe God has a word for many of us here tonight. And the questions on the back of your handout talk about actually writing your testimony. And thank you so much, Abel, for sharing, by the way. And the worship team, you guys can come on up. But let's not miss this opportunity to respond to God tonight. You know, have you written out your testimony? Have you written out your story? There's a guide to do that, both using the QR code to see the study guide questions on our website, or using the bulletin that was handed to you when you walked in. But what was your life like before Jesus? Did he come into your life? How did that happen? And what's your life like now? But let's really reflect on the ways that God has worked in our lives and not miss this opportunity to respond to him. Abel and team will be around at the Connect Pergola and at the Connect Cart. We'd love to talk to you more if God's working in your life. But don't miss that opportunity to pray with someone and really seal what God's doing in your life tonight.
Will you stand as we close our service in this chorus?
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I gave you my heart, I give you my soul.
Our lives would be a response to your love. Jesus, and we say that we need you to do that even, that we're helpless without you. Lord, we ask that this evening as we go from this place that we would be a light in this community. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Thank you for spending your Friday night with us. If you would like prayer, there's going to be a prayer team up here in the front in the sanctuary. And church like this happens because a lot of people volunteer and give their time. So if you have not found a place to give your time to this community, I promise you it'll be more rewarding than the effort it takes from you. And there's going to be iPads at the Connect tables if you'd like to see what type of opportunities there are. Awesome. Have a good evening.